was a pretty star. Yeah. And I'm into FPGAs. Yes. So.
Yeah, right.
Actually, at work, I don't do FPGA anymore, but still. So I will present this. So this is not my project, but it's quite a popular project right now. It's called FPGA Mister. So this is basically the hardware here. I will go through. So a bit of history. The project Mister emanated from an old project called MySt. So this was a project of someone designing an FPGA board to replicate the Atari ST, and ultimately became also able to run some Amiga and other. So the project became really a bit commercial. The guy never released the code. I think I'm not sure whether the code was released, but a lot of hardware was done, and a lot of it is inspired by this MAM, which is multi-arcade machine emulator. So this is really emulating some computers in hardware in an FPGA, and MAM is really a software emulation. So basically, a lot of arcade computers, even now synthesizers, actually emulated in software. So a lot of efforts go through this MAM project. People, for example, take the silicon chip, they decapitate, they take some microscope X-ray images, they reinverse the gates, etc., etc. So there's a huge amount of of efforts. And Mister is basically sort of an updated version of Mist, which is basically a better Mist in a sense, which is based on a very small nano Altera D nano board to emulate. Basically, it's like using the framework of Mist to actually emulate now arcade games, processors, all sorts of hardware dedicated for gaming arcade. So the hardware is based on an Altera Cyclone 5. So these are quite recent FPGAs in which you have also a NAM core A9, and you have HDMI, you have a DDR, quite a larger amount of DDR memory, and you can run a Linux system, and it's quite a cheap FPGA board. So this FPGA becomes the basis of that Mister project. In terms of software, a lot of the Mist and other projects, all the development have been incorporated. So they are developing what they call Core, which include very old computers. Probably some of you, probably a young one, don't know all these Archimede, Amstrad, all old computers. And also they also implement some Game Boy, Mega Drive, NES, etc. And also arcade, really arcade cores, which are really what was developed in the 80s, 90s, which was those born like cabinet in which inside you basically have a Z80, 68000 and a few chips. So there's really a huge amount of development. And then the last one is basically a little bit of code that tests the memory speed, which is another one I will show. So the motivation really is to develop 68000, all sorts of old microprocessors, as well as sound chips, and replicate Pac-Man, Galaxian, all these very old arcade games cabinet. So from a hardware point of view, people are also developing add-on board, including an additional SD RAM, so you have a sort of different card. I/O, so people can plug, let's say, a more recent USB joystick, and then people add like a fan to cool down the thing. RTC is to have the time clock, because the Linux, I mean Linux basically reboots, so you have to keep the time clock. Actually, that FPGA card has also Ethernet, so now the system has some script that really update everything, so it's quite nice to have a sort of transition instead of loading your stuff to some SD card. And then people now are even going into designing cases to render it as a small box. So in terms of wiki or GitHub, everything is put on this master development here. So actually all of this you can really access and participate, contribute, test. For people who want to actually learn FPGA in a simple way, in a sense, there's a lot of source code that you can read and learn from. And also the testing aspect is not really very, very strong at the moment. So, you know, it's a bit like the Linux kernel. You can actually contribute a lot to the documentation. For some of you who likes consoles, which you can buy on Carousel or eBay for maybe $100, or I recently bought an N64 for like $50. So you have the NES, Genesis, Game Boy, and then some a bit more complicated Neo Geo old consoles. And then people develop really arcade, let's say that game, 1943, which is like a game. So just to give you some sort of flavor of the sort of scene, there are three main people which I would like to basically introduce in that short presentation. The first one is called Smoke Monster. So that's a guy who's doing a lot of video and try to promote that project. Not a technical person as per se in terms of programming, but actually someone who really push and do some tests, etc., etc. And two technical guys. One is Jotego. So that's a guy who basically implemented a couple of games in a Verilog. Most of the time, it's Verilog onto the platform. And then one which I follow the most is Furtech, which they've tried to develop the Neo Geo console. So I will show at the end another slide which compare all the different sort of console, and you will see. So there's some video that basically show how we can show at the end. If there's some time. So like every other group, there's a lot of social media associated with it. So there's a Facebook page, there is a Twitter, feed and account. These days, a lot of discussion, like real-time sort of discussion, goes into some Discord servers, including a lot of FPGAs. A lot of Discord servers, I find they have quite related topics. One side is FPGA, and one side is actually this one. Actually, there's a lot of cross contamination, which is the good way of everything. And then there's a more traditional forum, which basically hosts some of the FPGA the discussion with Solvit. That's one guy who basically is an issue. So just to give you an example of what would be implemented as a quite complex console. So this is the diagram of a Neo Geo console. So just to explain a little bit, we have a 68,000 microprocessor which deal with sort of the game aspects. And then here we have a big GPU that reads from a cartridge. So I don't know if anyone has seen the cartridge of Neo Geo. They're massive, they have 400 pins. So a lot of it is try to basically replicate this into the one FPGA. And then usually there's a small Z80 who drives some Yamaha chip to do the sound aspect. So away from like the modern 4K TV HD resolution, those are really 300 by 200 pixels. By the time that was already quite good technology. A lot of this work for that specific console was to do with decapping chips, and actually found out and reverse engineer all those chips from SNK, that Japanese company. And also, this guy is also doing a lot of preservation of those consoles, i.e. some of those chips which were designed in the 1990 by Fujitsu basically now are failing. So they are trying to also replace some of those chips by more recent. So there is some electronic hacking at some point. This console is really the sort of the top that is achieved in this Mr. implementations. Another one which is quite interesting is this Arcade 143. So in the USA, if you want to buy a cabinet, you can still buy them for usually $500, that kind of preference. Some of them are actually quite expensive still. So this guy implemented this, so it's a Capcom, basically a game. And this used to be, so those Japanese companies used to have a wide range of hardware over the years. And then those have a very small Z80 and small little Yamaha chip. You see that's the resolution with the 256 color. So if, I don't know if anyone had their first computer with 256 color here. I don't think any of you had. So the interesting thing is that those guys tend to have this Patreon. I think it's very very popular now these days to basically work to some project and people sponsor you to basically develop the code, etc., and share with the community. And then all of the code is on the GitHub. So a lot of those codes were developed by other people for other projects. And it's a very nice, small, little game. So from what was advertised in the poster in those times compared to actually the game, so not comparing that to the PlayStation and all the most recent games. And then to remind you really of the large amount of actually consoles that used to be sold. That's probably showing my age, but they have like sort of first generation, the next one, and next one, etc., all the way to the Xbox One, PlayStation 4, etc. And of all of those, the Neo Geo, for example, was the most advanced at that time, and most probably the most expensive for its time. And you still actually find some for about $200 or $250 these days. Some of them used to be really the basic small Motorola 8 bits. A lot of those in the second generation had 68,000. And then when we come to those more recent ones, they are custom chips. So for example, the Nintendo for the N64, it was a collaboration with Silicon Graphics to develop some GPU. So, and I guess the most recent one here, it's basically a computer with a big GPU from AMD or NVIDIA. So when you have a small system that you can program and end up with, you know, those actually games, those ones become a bit more difficult in terms of memory and horsepower from a like Gates point of view. But the Jaguar has a lot of potential, and then some people are also working on adding CD-ROM, etc. to the system. Those Xbox, etc., I don't think these will be emulated because they become more advanced system. And actually, this is more like a retro kind of thing, so I don't really consider all of these to be retro. And also, this project is more about learning FPGA, hacking things, you know, trying to plug things into some hardware. Those, you just basically take a PC and MAM and you play with it. And then just to show the appeal of this is that recently NSK, that Japanese company, they moved into more software, meaning that all games are now ported to PlayStation 4 and Switch and other consoles. But recently there's a trend to actually create mini. So they released this mini Neo Geo, which I think included I think something like 50 games, more than 50 games. So between a console that you buy, $250, plus a large controller, which is really like an arcade, and then you slide a really massive massive cartridge that you have to find now to basically it's an arm with a huge compressed ROM. The quality is basically still quite good because you can still plug it to an HDMI. So actually, this is the so there is a trend like this to render. And then recently, I think there's also the Sega Mega Drive. So there's a mini one coming. So I also have one of these from some second-hand thing. This becomes also a very miniature version of things. And a lot of development could be done because actually this is, I don't know what's inside of this one, but it's very likely to be an FPGA and just a lot of So that's my presentation. If you are interested, something I can show some. So to just show you the sort of this was the video of Furtech. So you have the mister here. This is really development, or this is hacking stuff. He's basically implementing the very basic Neo Geo, and then he's starting some of this stuff here. I think is the video, and then it's just to show that actually he can really run the whole game onto the FPGA. Problem with Neo Geo is that the cartridge has 700 megabits of actually data, but actually when you look from an FPGA point of view, it's already quite huge for an FPGA. So this is just to, you know, to show that things are running. And so these are still games within sort of a 2D sprite, a lot of sprite. The next step will be 3D and sort of other animated stuff. Yeah, this one is the same. Yeah. So in terms of core, if I show you this one, so you have really the source code. The release is the file that you load into your FPGA, which is like a package thing. And afterwards, you have all the different parts of the game. So to really re-implement, you start from the schematics. And then you look at the gates, and then you implement. A lot of it is try to optimize or timing of things. And usually there's a very old processor, 6500. So inside, it's really yeah. And maybe for 2 minutes, just you know, to define some VHDL code. So you have to define like a memory, how things get clocked, etc. So you are not only like writing code for MAM, you basically write a lot of things that you abstract, but here you really are working from the schematic usually. So you really are replicating things from the original source. Whereas MAM, a lot of code was written trying to emulate in a way that you see, let's say, some sprite move, so you will copy, you will use OpenGL, God knows what to actually do, but actually, in those arcades, there was no OpenGL, it was actually real code. So, that's it for me. If you have any question or any, I will make the PDF available, so that will be the second FPGA talk of the year. So hopefully I will add more, and then we can demonstrate that in real with
demos next time.
Yeah.
The offices.
I got.
Thank you, man.
Thank you.